Today, rather than talking about bassoons, which I know is already a nerdy topic to begin with, I'm going to double down with Star Trek. One of my favorite childhood television shows was Star Trek. I think I've probably seen every episode of the whole franchise, yes, even the new ones. But one thing that continually bothers me is the fundamental change in character and direction in the franchise since the 2009 J.J. Abrams reboot, and calcified in every new installment. There's so much to talk about when it comes to the hits and misses of this direction, but this video is not an attempt at adding to the plethora of detailed breakdowns of lore or canon or whatever else you can find in other corners of YouTube. This is about music. Today, I'll focus my energy towards the theme music, or lack thereof, to the first new series since the reboot in 2009, and that is Star Trek Discovery, and why its main theme makes it one of the least memorable scores in the franchise history. So, are you ready for this? Space. The final frontier. These are the... Ah, screw it. Let's cut straight to the music. The fundamental elements that we so often overlook when it comes to the reception of a film or TV series is the music. This is especially the case in science fiction, which until only very recently was a genre which required its audience to let their own imaginations fill in where the sets, costumes, and special effects left gaps. Although crucial to the success of any screenplay is great writing and great acting, I would argue that great music is a close third. Now, I know that you understand this statement, but when you think back to the first time you watched Star Wars, imagine how different it could have been if John Williams had not gotten the gig for A New Hope. I would argue that it was the music in the most iconic sci-fi productions that inspired us to look past what we saw on screen and connected us on an emotional level, or even a spiritual level, to the story that was taking place before us and to the characters portrayed. As visual effects budgets rose, coupled with the stunning capabilities of computer modeling and other special effects technologies, as well as their increasing affordability, Hollywood and the major networks have loaded up with their headline shows in ways so as to leave very little to the imagination of the audience. This is especially apparent in Discovery, which is on another visual level compared with any of its small screen predecessors. Unfortunately, though the visuals are an improvement by an order of magnitude, the music doesn't stand out. I should say that scoring for film is by no means my expertise, and there is no objective standard by which any classical musician can critique the effectiveness of this genre. I also want to point out that what I'm not commenting on in this video is the ambient or functional music, which makes up, of course, the vast majority of the work product for the composer Jeff Rousseau. In fact, on that level, the quality, variety, and complexity of the score is by far better than its predecessors, but then again, not memorable. Now, I don't have to play the themes of the Star Trek series of the past, because if you've gotten this far in this video, then you'll know all of them, probably, at least in part. There are two standout musical moments in Star Trek history, among many, that we will take a quick look at, just to emphasize how well-composed themes, in the classical music sense, have helped us along in filling what was left unsaid. The first example is from the beginning of Star Trek The Motion Picture, the film which coincidentally was also a reboot of the franchise. The film opened with a scene which completely reimagined the favorite foes of Captain Kirk and his crew, the Klingons. Now, rather than continuing the low-budget look of angry bearded dudes in brown face...
Those are Klingons? They are Klingons. And it is a long story.
This one scene reset the species in our minds, not just how they looked, but also their ethos, and the music was hugely important in contributing to that. The theme is based mainly on the interval of a perfect fifth, which is a common interval in martial music or in music which we associate with militarism. I can imagine that this comes from natural horns, which, if they have no holes or valves, are reduced to playing notes in the harmonic series. Anyway, the instrumentation of the theme is interesting. It's out of tune. It sounds like a combination of an oboe, a French horn, maybe a low flute or pianissimo clarinet, I'm not sure. And in the background, there's a muted trumpet playing a drone. All the while underneath lies a stable pulsation of a dry skin drum, piano, pizzicato strings, and this curious clicking instrument. I'm not sure what that is. Later, the theme gets taken over by a mute trumpet, and then we're kind of off to the races. We see the Klingons for the first time. Again, we hear the language, we see the sets and the costumes. Now remember, this is first minute of music sets the stage for the whole reimagination of the species. If YouTube were around in 1979, I'm sure there would be thousands of videos and blog posts speculating about the scene and the reimagination. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is that though they only get about 4 minutes on screen, the music helps us imagine what the Klingons are. Militaristic, unrefined, relentless. In combination with the visual element, we have a much fuller picture or idea of what this reimagined foe might become in the franchise. The next example is taken from Star Trek The Next Generation, an episode called The Inner Light. In the episode, Captain Picard is incapacitated by an ancient alien probe. During his time unconscious, Picard experiences what it was like to live a lifetime as a member of the now extinct species who built the probe.
Jump to conclusions, Matt. You see, it would be this Matt.
Anyway, you can watch the episode for yourself. But during this experience, Picard learns to play a flute, and the instrument accompanies him during that lifetime. As a memento of the experience when Picard wakes up, it turns out that the flute that he had played was stored in the probe the Enterprise discovered at the beginning of the episode, and the whole show is wrapped up with him playing the flute's theme. This scene is so simple and yet so effective. From the moment we see him take the flute out of the box, there are no words which could match the effectiveness of the combination of Patrick Stewart's acting and the music. Not only is the theme a reflection upon Picard's experiences and memories, it's a reminder that music for so many is a way that one can remember events with sensory cues. We listen to a song we know well, and we remember the moments when we may have shared that song with others, or a time in our lives that we associate that song with. The most important message to take away from this episode, I think, is that when we are taken far enough through time and space from an ancient civilization to the point where one individual's memories cannot be passed on to another, The act of remembering that civilization comes through the fragments of its culture that it left behind, its art, its monuments, its literature, and its music. Now, here's where I'm being unfair. I've just given you two examples which have specific contextual importance, but are not main title sequences. However, what I'm trying to point out in this video is that these examples are clearly creations of more traditional classical music compositional forms. The flute theme is just a simple 16-bar melody in 3/4 time, but there is an implied harmonic structure to it. The Klingon theme is the same and uses our own inherited cultural references like the perfect fifth motif to help us build an impression of what we are seeing or going to see. So you can imagine my disappointment when it comes to the theme of Star Trek Discovery, which is almost purposefully nondescript. The only decipherable melody is the copy-paste of Alexander Courage's theme, which comes at the end of the title sequence. You know it. That one. There are one or two interesting similarities to previous title scenes that Mr. Russo builds into the title sequence. First of all, instrumentation. Though the melody is modified, the Glockenspiel, which gives those classic punctuations, is almost identical to that which opens Alexander Courage's original theme. The melody that follows, if we can call it that, is performed by a French horn, which also carries the initial melodic statements in the themes to Deep Space Nine and Voyager. Next, form. I find it curious that Mr. Russo chose to cut the movement into two parts, the first part being a rather ambient introduction with an emphasis on texture. You can hear the use of harmonics and interesting bow technique in the strings. And the second part being, well, let's call it the main theme, where the cello enters. This ambient introduction links directly to the title sequences of the original series in The Next Generation, as they both had that classic voiceover. You know what I'm talking about.
Space, the final frontier.
What is such a curious decision here is to include this kind of quiet textural backing track when there is no voiceover. I spent an afternoon the other day transcribing what I could so as to make an harmonic analysis of that second section. What I came up with was this. So though it seems as if the piece is composed in D minor, there is a really forced modulation in that final section, which ends on what sounds to me like a Phrygian cadence in A flat minor. It's not quite that. Anyway, harmonically speaking, A flat minor doesn't really fit into the scheme, and to my ears, it doesn't actually sound like we've modulated that far away. It sounds more like we end in E flat major as the tonic, although arriving to it from the Neapolitan, the bar before. Obviously, this is some very technical musical language, but I thought this might be interesting to you. You can see, certainly on the bottom line, but also in the second line, that I have a hard time trying to work out the analysis because the harmonic structure of the piece rides the line of being post-tonal. The bass motif of offsetting the arpeggio rhythmically while resetting the pattern at a harmony change is a common film scoring technique ported from minimalist composers like Philip Glass. It was also hard for me to hear exactly how the patterns went, so after about the first six bars, I just wrote in a kind of general riff using the right harmony. As you can tell, it doesn't fall into a strictly classical framework. This is okay, it doesn't have to. But the fact that a harmonic structure is not particularly clear, in combination with a melodic line which has no lyrical quality whatsoever, gives the listener very little to grab onto. Furthermore, the sci-fi compositional trope of using a minor triad with an added flat sixth, as well as the Neapolitan chord, is heavily used here. I'm sure you've heard this harmonic idea many times before, but didn't quite clue in. This is what it sounds like. And here are a few examples of it in sci-fi music. The flat sixth, the Neapolitan chord usage has become typecast in sci-fi, and I find it rather a shame that it was such a prominent feature in this discovery theme. So if you combine all of these elements, homage in form to previous Star Trek themes, a bland melody coupled with a commonly used compositional rhythmic pattern underlined by generic sci-fi harmonic tropes, what it makes is a pretty uninteresting and not very memorable theme, which is rather sad, because it sort of indicates, to me at least, that the producers didn't really know the direction or the character of the show that they were creating when they were first developing it. And therefore, we as the audience don't get a clear idea what the show's about either. Now, I'm not saying that good film music has to be built on a lyrical Western classical score. I'm just saying that there's too much ambiguity in this particular one, and that not enough artistic risks were taken so as to make a statement that could help us interpret the direction, the character, the emotional context of the show. I'm kind of at a loss for words here, so just bear with me. In any case, it was too safe, and therefore not memorable. So I'm coming to you now from the editing station after having done the title sequence, and I just realized that the original series theme is a great example of a non-classical tradition theme, which works so well and is obviously the very distinctive one that we remember very, very well. It has a very distinctive melody, it has a counter melody, and it also has wonderful voice leading in the inner voices. You can hear that in the brass section in that final phrase, for example. And I think it's very important to point out that, you know, you don't have to come from a classical tradition in order to make a classic or distinctive Star Trek theme. It's just that this one in Discovery didn't hit the nail on the head. And, well, let's be honest that there are worse sci-fi themes out there. It's been a long road. Nope. Well, if you agree or disagree with me, please write a comment. And if you enjoy these videos, then please consider becoming a patron via Patreon. And don't forget to like here on YouTube, share, and subscribe. So thanks for watching. Take it easy.